So my name is Ashok Sinha. I primarily started off as a travel photographer, and I still do quite a lot of travel photography. And here I'm going to show you how I use my work in finding different audiences and avenues. So maybe you take a bit of inspiration from it. I have to warn you that I'm not a tech head. So what I believe in is I believe that we are all artists, and we manifest that in different ways. And that's been my driving force behind what I do. So yes, the camera is a tool, but primarily it's my curiosity and my passion for what I do is drives me and gets me certain places. Speaking of which, I've been to a lot of places. I'm sure some of you have been as well. And there's some numbers that I keep a tally of, believe it or not. I kind of look at it and I'm saying, wow, this is kind of fun. And as when I go to these places, obviously I'm making pictures, either for myself or usually on assignment, and ends up being a lot of images, right? Now, the thing is, I have been published, I've been honored to be published and lucky to have been published in many different avenues and outlets editorially, and some of them are on the screen. But the whole point when I talked to David, and first of all, I forgot to mention, thank you for having me, B&H. And I talked to David, he's a good friend of mine, and I've worked with B&H for a number of years now. So when I sat down with David and talked about what I'm going to say in my presentation, I wanted to show that through this body of work that I do for maybe an assignment for a project, there's always something I'm doing for myself. And that for myself is how I create these bodies of work that find different audiences. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take you through a few bodies of work, and I'm gonna show you the genesis of how they came to being and how I got started and where I get my inspiration from. So one of these assignments, so a little bit before that is actually about travel photography. So what is travel photography? The beauty is that travel photography has the benefit, and that's where I find inspiration from, is a lot of different genres. It involves the landscapes. I love shooting landscapes. It has food elements in it. It's a very important part of any travel story. Portraits, obviously. A sense of the place, the people who are part of the landscape, what they're about. Architecture, a big part of what I do, commercially as well, aside from my editorial work is architecture. Details. Always the, photo editors always love details, and I love details because even though when I'm shooting them, when I look at it later, I find something in it that I didn't see before, and something that's easily missed. And obviously candids and spontaneity of travel and just a reportage style of work. So I'm gonna take you through a typical assignment that I shot a few years ago in Cairo, and how I thought about this body of work, which is now pretty well developed. And one thing I have to say is all these bodies of work I'm going to show you takes a lot of time to develop. Unlike an assignment, which is, I'm given a specific amount of time, I'm going there and shooting it for a purpose. These things happen. I have to sit on it, I have to think about it, and then when I find the right opportunity, I go and shoot it. So how I use my travels is a way to put me in the right places so that I have that idea in mind beforehand and I can apply it based on where I'm at, if the idea fits. So a typical travel assignment, I was in Cairo, and one of my favorite cities. I really enjoy the city life, and it was about a story about Cairo on the cusp. And in an opener shot, usually a sense of place, where you are. And it started with near Tahrir Square, and the buildings. I love shooting nightscapes, and right after dusk when the lights are just the same levels as when the sun sets. So it's a nice opener shot. And this is not the final edit that was published. This was an edit that I created. And then again, spontaneity, like I said, moments like this would give you a sense of what this space is about. There are people, this guy, this little boy with the bread on his head. Sometimes you get lucky and you find these moments. Sometimes you have to just wait for it and hope and wish that you're in a situation and it's gonna happen most likely. In this case, it was a busy bakery on the other side, and I knew that somebody's gonna come up with a basket of bread, and I have to shoot it. And then there are scenes like this, daily scenes, the mosque, the architecture, some of the elements I mentioned, portraits. Happens to be when I first saw this, his portrait was on the wall, a younger, obviously a younger portrait. And I noticed it, and I said, oh my God, like, can I do your portrait? And he said, yeah, sure. But I wanted to place him in the right position, so I chose that spot because it said something about him and also about the place where I was shooting. And again, then the markets. I don't know how many of you have been to Cairo, but it's a fascinating place just to walk around the markets and show and give people a sense of what this place is about. Food, I love food. So one of the reasons I love to travel is to eat. And when I find things like this, I have to photograph it. And usually, you know, when you see a picture that makes people hungry, then you know that picture has been successful. And to me, I try to capture those moments. And that's why I, you know, differentiate between what is a great photograph and what is a successful photograph. And you can find many, many technical faults, you know, flaws probably, but as a photograph, I think it's successful because it kind of gives you a sense of being there. And that's what travel photography is about. And again, these moments, you know, locals I love. I mean, I'm lucky to have a camera as my tool. And one of the best things that I have as a photographer is to meet people when I'm traveling. Like these two guys, you know, hanging out, smoking a shisha. And I said, hey, can I sit down and have a chat with you? And then, you know, I sat down, smoked a shisha, had a tea. And then when I was leaving, I said, you know what, I have to get a portrait because that was my initial idea. But I wouldn't have gotten this portrait if I just walked up to them and said, hey, can I do your portrait? So you have to take the time to be part of the thing, to live it. And then you can see your pictures will really show the connection between, and that's what portraits, taking portraits, the connection between you and the person, because there's that, you know, there's that object of the camera in between. So you have to make that disappear somehow. And details, you know, like I said, details are very important to pair it when you do pairings, even if you're doing your own, say your own books, be it a blurb photo book or an assignment for a photo editor. A detail paired with a wider shot is always a great spread. So then, you know, my assignment led to, you know, I was still in Cairo shooting this, and I wanted to shoot this urban landscape because it was, you know, part of where, what the place was about, and I saw the buildings, and I went up to the top of this mosque, and I saw this picture, and when I made this picture, it made me think of one picture I did about a year and a half prior to this, and this was from the top of the Empire State Building in New York City, and made me think about urban. And at that time when I saw it from the top of the Empire State Building, I'll show you this picture at the very end, just to keep the suspense. when I made that picture, I thought of one thing, like, you know, when we live in Manhattan in an urban environment, we forget to think of scale. When we look at scale, what does it mean? Like, how can I document a view of the world which is different from what we always see normally, right? And I came up with a picture which put the scale in perspective, where I wanted to document the world and all the communities around the world using the horizon as a common denominator and putting really, you know, the urban environment or any other community in perspective. So when I walked up there, I saw this. Now I came back, and that's one of the things I'll talk about. You know, when you find something great, you may not have the picture right away, but you might have to go back there or, you know, see something, you observe the light. And I said, you know, when the sun started setting, and, you know, sadly, because of pollution, there's a lot of pollution in Cairo, the light had a very interesting filtering effect. And I said, you know what, I can do this. I can. It reminded me of the picture I did in New York, and I abstracted the landscape, and I came up with that. So that was my shot of Cairo. And this is, again, this was not for the assignment. This was not for anyone. This was just for me. And this is how I build my bodies of work for me. And hopefully, I can say something through my pictures. So I took this idea and I replicated it everywhere I go. In fact, I was just overseas. I just came back this weekend and I did a similar picture in Athens. And I consider all my bodies of fine art work as living and breathing bodies of work. They're not static. They're always continuously growing. And unless and until I feel like it's completely done, it'll keep on happening. This was in Cairo, this was also in Egypt, this was in Giza, and I always try to include elements that give you a sense of scale. This was in Uruguay, if you haven't been to Uruguay, please go. This is an amazing, amazing country, very underrated, but fabulous opportunities for travel photography, and more importantly, amazing food, like I said, and amazing people. So this is in Cabo Polonio in Uruguay. This is, I don't know if anyone can guess, Rio, you got it. This is one of the few places on earth that I think the beach is always populated. No one leaves. Middle of the night, morning. So this had to be part of my series because this was the life. You know, people led that life during the day and the night. And I came back and I photographed it during the day. This is in Chile, in the Atacama Desert, a small city. And when I landed, I first saw this and I said, I have to go back there on the way back to the airport because my assignment led, you know, I had to go be there at a certain point to shoot somebody. And then I said, I'm going to have some time on the way back. I'm going to park my car and I'll walk all the way across and photograph this. So that's how I do these bodies of work. I can constantly build on top of each other. This was in Portugal. This is a beautiful place on the coast near Lisbon. Again, the houses and the colors, and it's just a variety of landscape I wanted to capture. This is in Fort Collins, Colorado. I was there for a show opening. Some of my works were in a show. I'm going to show you some of that. And when I was going, I was driving to the exhibition space with the gallerist. I said, oh my God, this is an amazing landscape, but the light wasn't there. So I said, I'm going to come back. I'm going to wait for the light. Maybe I'll get lucky. A couple of days, I'll give it a shot, and maybe I'll have it. And I did. So I'm always on the hunt. I'm not a farmer. I'm a hunter. So I'm always on the hunt for scenes like this. When I find something that will fit a series, I keep that in mind and I keep going for it. This is in Los Angeles. One of the few days that there was not much smog in the sky. And this is a very popular image that's been in LA because a lot of people from LA see this image and like, oh my God, I can't believe you can actually see downtown. And this was from Runyon Canyon Park, another place where I was shooting for a project for a magazine. And I saw this and I said, this will never be published in a magazine, but this will be great for my series. And this is the image that inspired me to do this. This was shot a year prior to the image I showed you in Cairo. And the reason why this sky is magenta is not Photoshop. It is actually true. It was a cloudy night, and they used to put these colored lights, and they still do, but it's a different kind of lights. But it used to be the old school gel. They put a gel on the light, as in a colored paper on the light, and they would light up the top of the Empire State Building. And that night, they had a magenta color. And from where I live, I could see the Empire State Building, and I said, this is the night to go shoot this picture, which is for a different story. And when I saw this, I said, oh my God, can you believe that we live in Manhattan and we never get to know the scale and what it is? And when you put that thing, so I had this idea in my mind and I kind of took that and replicated that, creating this series exacting proportion. So I'm going to move on to another body of work. I was on a documentary project in Xinjiang, China, which is the northwest corner of China, and a story about Muslims in China, Uyghurs in China. And that guy over there, he was my fixer. In PhotoSpeak, fixers are essentially a very important part of what we do. They are translators, they're facilitators, they get you introduced, they take you to places where you may not have access to. And most of the time, these are normal people. There are professional fixers out there, but my favorites are the people who are normal, everyday people. So I was shooting the story, and the landscape is pristine. It is beautiful. And the day we were driving up, this is about 14,000, 15,000 feet above sea level, so it's, you know, pretty high up there. When we went to this place, I saw this landscape, and he stopped. He said, we have to stop, we have to stop. And I said, why? I mean, I knew it. I wanted to photograph it. It was beautiful. He said, no, you don't understand. This place is never like this. It only happens maybe once a year. And he said he's probably seen it a few times in his entire lifetime. And he said, normally it's all hazy because those are sand hills in the background. And the wind blows, you know, blows up the sand, and it's all hazy. And you never see the sky. You never see this, you know, electric blue in the sky. You never see this landscape. And he said he had to take a moment. He walked down. He had to take a moment to connect with his land. You know, he had to just be there to experience that moment. And that, to me, was almost like locating a sacred place, you know, for him, right? So I had this thing. I said, you know what? This is a sacred moment for this man. You know, because even though we're doing all these things, we're going to do this project, for him, this is a point of time he wants to remember. And I said, you know, this is something that maybe I can build upon. And I can recreate this idea. Maybe it doesn't exist, but maybe I can search for it. And I said, you know, maybe this series is going to be called Locating the Sacred. And, you know, I had this idea. Again, I travel, you know, I go on, you know, projects and places like this. This is in California. And I was shooting a project in the Death Valley. If you haven't been, that's one of my other places, which is my favorite place to shoot. And again, this man just walked up and he stood there. And maybe he's not even thinking what I'm thinking, but that's fine art. This is what I want to think. This is what I want to make out of it. So I took this idea and I said, and this was early in the morning. As you all know as photographers, that early morning light is great, or afternoon light is great. So this was calm, pristine. I think it was my manifestation locating. I was locating my sacred spot, maybe, like when you're there, when you're quiet by yourself and shooting it. And I said, you know, this is great. I want to do this again. I'm playing with scale again in that perspective, but I'm giving it a certain meaning, which to me made total sense and still does. And then this was in Australia, and I recently showed it to a friend who's from Australia. And she said, oh my God, I know exactly where that is. But how did you create this moment, which is so quiet and sacred? I'm like, oh my God, you said sacred. I'm like, yeah, this is my series. I call locating the sacred. And you know, this woman who she was in the pool, and she was just sitting there for like a good 10 minutes. And I said, this is perfect for what I do, for my series. And then there is another shot, which I knew this image was going to happen, because I knew this man was at the bottom of the hill, and he's going to walk up there, and he's going to have that moment where he would just stand there and look at the landscape or whatever he was doing. And I said, I have to capture it. So I waited there, I waited for the right moment, and I said, okay, this again, for my inbox of ideas and inspiration, it's gonna be there for the series. And this one, again, is in Chile, like I said, the same assignment, actually, which got me the other picture for exacting proportion, got me this shot. And this guy was moving around, I had to obviously wait. When I find a frame, I wait. I really, really wait, and I pray a lot to whatever God will help me. So I pray, and usually when you really want something like that, it happens. And he was there, and everybody else disappeared, and he was there. He just stood there, and it was happened to be, again, as luck might have it, a full moon. So it just made the picture. Now this series, again, going back to urban environments, and this is going back to Uruguay. I was shooting that story, and this was in Montevideo. And I'm always amazed by urban homes, urban landscapes. And when I saw this, I said, even before I shot anything else, I said, this is going to be a great thing for me to keep. And this is going to be one day going to be a series where I can literally contrast how people live around the world. And how I can contrast, like, you know, what apartments are and what it is. And it's going to be a really, really cool series. So I started doing this. And I began to notice the beauty of this picture. What I like this picture is, when I look at this picture, you know, for the first time, okay, it's a picture. And then I start to notice details. I start to notice the windows, what's going on. And you know, these were finally printed as large prints for the show. So you could actually, people were just like standing in front of the picture and noticing detail, like, what brand is the air conditioner? I mean, doesn't matter, but you know, people were looking at that kind of stuff, you know? And people ask me, oh, did you like ask this person to like direct and stand at the window? I'm like, no, it doesn't happen that way. You know, I take a lot of pictures. It's not just one shot. So, and then I choose as to which one makes sense. And this was the start of another series. And this was in Poland. I actually initially was drawn to the shot which was published. It was this couple looking out the window. And I had laser focus. I wanted them to come to this window and looking down, this elderly couple, and look beautiful. And then when I stepped back, and once my shot was done, I said, oh my God, I can't believe I'm standing in front of this building, which will give me another image for my series. How cool is that? So I stepped back and I said, let me look at this in a different scale. And I stepped back and I made the shot. And similar ideas, this is in Toronto, actually. And the first thing I noticed, I said, okay, this is I know it's right there. And when I saw the curtains and everything, and I have variations of this picture. But when I saw this, I said, this is perfect for my home series. And eventually it was actually a part of a show which was called Home. And my series was perfect. And the curator said, now, did you think about this show when you were shooting this? I'm like, no, this is shot over a number of years. And I always had this idea. And I waited for this opportunity for the show to come up. And I wanted to show this work. So that's how I show my, you know, fine art, limited edition work, whatever you may call it. I call it differently depending on the body of work, but that's how I go about it. This is in China. Again, you know, air conditioners. which is, if you look at these images, and the fun part is when you put these images side by side, you see that you see similarities, you see differences, but at the end of the day, you find that we are a lot similar. You know, we might be living in New York, we might be from different countries, different cultures, but at the end of it, we are all thinking about the same things, you know? And that's the beauty of capturing pictures and having meaning to the pictures. So this was in China after that shot, and I bring back another series now. So I shoot in LA quite a bit for a couple of publications there. So, you know, a few times a year I go to LA. And my wife's from LA too, so we travel back and forth. And so when I started traveling on the plane, you know, there's boredom and whatnot. But I always, you know, I'm always one of the, you know, the little kid, you know, looking out the window, you know, and I don't know what I'm looking at. But one day I realized when I was traveling, I said, oh my God, most people on this airplane don't realize the amazing landscape that exists in this country, and we're flying right over it, right? How can I capture this? And I don't have any special equipment. Again, I'm not a gearhead, like I said. I don't have any special equipment. I don't have a chopper that's flying me around, although I'd love to. If anyone in the audience has one, please talk. I'd love to talk to you. And I don't have anything special, but I want to make this accessible to people. Like, how can someone, anyone can make this happen? So what I started doing was I started photographing only the 5 minutes after takeoff and 5 minutes before landing. Because that's the only time you can take a picture where the plane either tilts or it's closer, and you can have the right angles. And then I became, you know, went a step further. I started to take like flights which would not be a direct flight, so I could, you know, fly over landscapes, you know. And then I looked at sites like Seed Guru to figure out, you know, where the propeller is or the wing is. You know, I won't be obstructed again. You know, it is, you know, also chance based, because if there's a smudge on the window, then I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe. And I would talk to somebody, hey, can I change the seat or something like that. But that's what I always strive, and how I can make myself, you know, how I could be also working while I'm, you know, traveling somewhere, you know. So this is how it started, and this is the Great Salt Lake of Utah. And at certain times of the year, it has these amazing colors. And so I photographed a few landscapes like this, and this is again an ongoing body of work that has found its home in different venues in the States. But I just love doing this, because then you have things like this, and you never get to see, you know, once you fly over certain parts of the country and you know flight paths and whatnot, and you can know, like, you know, there's a good chance you might be able to capture that picture. And then this was, I remember, I don't know why I did this, but this was a flight in the middle of winter through, I took the flight to fly through Minnesota. Not because I wanted to get stuck in the airport, but because I knew this might happen, right? And I said, chances are this might happen. And I was excited, you know, and no one else could really understand why I'd be excited in flying, you know, through Minnesota in the middle of winter. But this landscape wouldn't happen now. So again, I was lucky, but I also worked for my luck. And it happened that I was able to capture this picture. And again, I'm showing you the successful ones. There are many unsuccessful ones. So it's a process. This is the Grand Canyon, part of the Grand Canyon. And I wanted to take a different take on the Grand Canyon because I'm interested in patterns. I get a lot of inspiration from painting and also abstract work, which I don't get to show this work in on a publication. So this is my other outlet for showing this kind of work. Now this brings us to this body of work, which is very different. So last year in November, I was really lucky to go to Antarctica with Lindblad Expeditions, who are one of the sponsors of this event. And it was an amazing, amazing trip. And I knew I wanted to go to Antarctica not to shoot icebergs, because I've seen them many, many times. I said, you know what, I want to do something different. I wanted to do something that says something about what I want to communicate to these pictures. So these pictures are actually, it's a work in progress, it's not complete yet. I've been working on it for the last 4 months now, because these are shot in November-ish. And I work on it a little bit at a time, because it, like as many good things in life, it takes time to develop. And finally you sit down and you look at it and you're like, oh, it's not there yet. So this is actually a composite. So I was inspired by the paintings of Edwin Church, and in the 1800s, in the mid-1800s, he went on a voyage to the North Pole, actually, and recreated these paintings of icebergs, which actually did not exist. And these were drawings. And so my take on that as a photographer is to recreate these icebergs that don't really exist. So these are imaginary icebergs. So the way it was done is the same one was photographed multiple times, different angles, different light conditions, and I'm still compositing them. I'm showing this work, it's still a work in progress. I'm still doing this to figure out, you know, one day I love it, and the next morning I wake up, I'm like, oh my God, I'm not really feeling it. And there's, you know, as photographers and artists, we all know this term about not feeling it. And how do you define the not feeling it part? Which basically means go back and work on it again. So this has been in the studio in the hopper for the last 4 or 5 months, and I'm hoping by the way, while I'm doing this work, I show this work to a lot of people who I respect their opinion, or I show it to other people, because that also gives me inspiration in getting feedback, because we all need great feedback, and constructive feedback. So this is a series I'm building on. These are composites, and there'll be another element that will be overlaid on top of it. So what I want to capture is the essence that ice and icebergs, and it's not static. It's actually moving in time. Because everywhere we went, when we saw this, for example, the first thing people said, oh my God, we were here last week. It looked completely different. Oh my God, this morning, it wasn't like this. And this afternoon, chances are it'll melt away or become something else. So I wanted to capture that. I wanted to bring that, you know, that idea in my pictures. I was inspired by paintings, and I go, like I said, I go to the Met all the time, and I look at paintings, and I said, this is going to be a great series to work upon. This is before I went, by the way. Didn't happen after. So, because one thing I knew that I didn't want to come back with icebergs only. Again, this is like another part of an iceberg. This is a composite overlaid on top of each other. And again, the element that's missing is I'm going to include the motion piece of it a little bit more. I think I need to work on that. There are details, you know, I love abstract details of icebergs. And more importantly, when you take things out of context and you try to do something else from what is in front of you, it becomes more interesting. And after all, and that's why everyone's an artist in their own right. Everybody. I'm a firm believer in that. So if you think you have an idea, just go out and do it. There's no time to think about I spend the most amount of time thinking about I'm going to do something. But once I start doing it, I really enjoy it. So the longest time is actually the part when you're debating, hesitating, whether I should try it or not. Try out every idea you have in your head. I'm telling you, you have original ideas. And only people, when others see it, then you're like, oh my God, I didn't know I had this in me. Again, this is a detail of another iceberg overlaid. And these were actually two moving icebergs. These are two different times of the day. Another last one from this series, which is another detail of these drops of water from the edge of this ice block. All right, so now I'll talk a little bit about single images as well. I talked about series, single images as well. So this is actually from a documentary story I recently did for Time. And this is about a tiny, tiny Jewish community in Calcutta, India, where I was born. So when I approached the story, in this case, I knew I had to do portraits, I had to do certain aspects of the story that I wanted to capture. You know, I'm not really thinking as to, is it going to be good enough for the editor or whatever. I'm doing it for myself. I'm doing it because I know every picture I make is going to have my signature on it. And I don't know after this story is published where it's going to go, who's going to like it, who wants to publish it. So when I did this shot, you know, I actually initially thought this was going to be a picture in a show. And long behold, after the story was published, there was a show at the Center for Fine Art Photography in Colorado for portraits. And I submitted my work. And I said, you know what, even though it's a documentary, it's an editorial story, I think it has power in it. And it has something about portraiture, about environmental portraiture, and who this person is. So I photographed this and ended up being actually one of the opening pictures of the show. This is Shalom, by the way. If anyone's interested in the story, look up Last Jews of Calcutta. 21 people left in this tiny, tiny community. This is another one I have. This was also in a show for portraits, and I wanted to submit this picture. This was an interior of a home, and to me, portrait can mean different things. And to me, this was a portrait of this place, and this was a house. And again, my interest in architecture, my interest in interiors, led me to create this image, which ended up being in a show. This was actually done on an assignment for Getty. So, never made there. This was just done for me. Another travel assignment I was on, it was in Morocco. So this is the big square in Marrakesh. And they have all these food stalls. And I said, oh my God, I have to eat. So I ate. And I wanted to, you know, I was doing this story, this series I have on markets. And I'm not going to show that series. But this was a picture from that series called Markets. And I captured it. And it's been in, like, you know, I think this year PDN did it in World, whatever, their focus travel awards or whatever. It was published there. It was in a show. It was in an auction that raised money for charity. I mean, the possibilities are limitless. You know, you just have to have, I mean, I just wanted to make a great picture because it captured that moment, that sense of place. And so I, you know, again, this was, I chose the right night. It was rainy. Rainy nights make good pictures. When it's colder, there's more smoke, more drama. So, you know, I obviously knew that was going to go on. Again, this is, again, another one from a travel assignment. This is in Vietnam, in Hoi An, where they have floating houses. And there's a story about these communities on water. And this actually never ended up being published, but it ended up being did really well as a print. As a print in shows, as a print in auctions, as print for my private clients. So you just never know. The thing is that when I see something that says something to me, I capture it. And then I don't worry about the edit or whatever it is. But at the same time, I knew I had to be at this place. I wanted to capture silhouettes. I wanted to capture the scale, the beautiful light. And you know, over time, I like golden hour, but I've also liked to dislike golden hour. Because sometimes I feel, my love changes for light over time. This was at a moment in my time where I didn't like golden hour. And I said, you know, after the sun set, the sky was different. It was a little, the light quality was different. And I wanted to capture that, the silhouettes and the dog. I was waiting for that dog for the longest time, believe it or not. I don't know if anybody noticed, but that's a very important part of my picture. Because I felt like, what if you were a dog on this island or this community, right? You can only jump from boat to boat or house to house. I mean, what kind of a life? I mean, imagine life of a dog on this in this place. Anyways, all right. So some things that I keep in mind. And again, these are things I've learned. This is not meant to be prescriptive, but things I've learned to do and be better at or just to keep in mind. So any place I go, regardless, whether I'm going on assignment, personal travels, or anything, I always Google my destination to death. You know, I just Google it, and you just never know what you're gonna find. I have found things like people's personal blogs, always a wealth of information, and things you would never see published. Someone might write, someone who is from that place might write something about a unique aspect of a place that you never knew. For example, a story I did, one of my travel stories I did was my first, but I really enjoyed it, was also write a story for the magazine. And I also did the research myself. And I had certain constraints. The hotel couldn't be more than $150 a night. It had to be in a certain environment. It had to have a charm. So I found this place in Santiago, Chile, which was the former French ambassador's residence, which is now being, you know, rented out as a hotel. And I found this on a blog. You know, when I found this, I said, oh my God. And I looked it up nowhere. And when I went there eventually, they said, oh, they just started about like a couple of months prior to that. And so you just never know what you're going to find. A lot of times I also find, and also another thing I do is I also look at like, you know, major sites like stock sites like Getty. I'm guessing that you know what stock photography is. It's basically images that people have shot. It's in an archive somewhere for people to license commercially. So Getty Images is one. Corbis Images is one. Aurora Photos. There's a few of them. I mean, if you just do a Google, again, if you do Google on stock photography websites, you'll get a sense of what people have shot, what this place is about. Sometimes, you know, things change so fast. Like for my landscapes, I always look for vantage points. Where is a good place for a hike? or people look for panoramas or whatnot, because you just don't know some of these hidden. This recent shot I did for in LA, it was actually an opener. It's on my website right now. It was actually in a public park in downtown Los Angeles that they do a lot of movie shoots, and I had no idea, even though my wife is from LA, and then, you know, she didn't know how to get to that place, but I Googled it, and somebody on a blog said, well, there's a secret entrance, you can go and bypass this guy or whatever. So anyways, long story short, Google. what else do I do? You know, I always have an idea in mind, and it's always better than going there and coming up with one, because then, instead of just capturing pictures, you'll actually make pictures. And that's a big difference, because if you have an idea in mind, then it, even though, like I said, you know, many of my pictures are unsuccessful, at least I work towards something, and I go and I keep working at it. So that is a very important aspect, that I have sort of an idea in mind before I go. I also look at Tourism Bureau websites, very underappreciated resource and asset online, because these governments put in a lot of money to promote the destinations, and some of these hidden places that you would not find, maybe they haven't been covered in a major publication or a magazine or whatever. Maybe it's on the tourism website. And then another site which may not be that important or useful for you, but Lightstalkers is another website where you can find local fixers, students who can basically show you around the city. You know, and then it's useful for my assignments when I'm looking for a local, then they know their way around and stuff like that. Once you get there, and I've done this many times, is I get trigger happy on the first day. You know, and I'm like, oh my God, this is amazing. Click, click. And you know, with digital, you think like, oh, I'm gonna take so many pictures, but actually, it's actually slowed me down. Because something that's amazing, when you first see it, and you've never seen it as different culture, you see that again. If there's nothing special, other than just being in an exotic location, or in an unfamiliar location, you might think this is just an ordinary picture. So I always try to, it's very hard. I have this problem that I'd like to capture it right away, but I learned to slow myself down. I said, let's not be trigger happy. Let's just evaluate the situation and see what images are worthy of making and what my game plan is gonna be for the next few days. The other thing I do is now have, you know, apps on my phone. I'm sure all of you do. It tells you, I used to do that in the past where first thing I would ask a question to in a hotel lobby is like, what time sunrise? What time sunset? You know? And they're like, oh, you know, the best place to see the sunrise? I'm like, no, I don't want to know that. I just want to know the time because I want to, you know, plan for the light as to when it's going to be the good light for me to go out. Can I have my breakfast and go or should I need to leave right away? So sunset and sunrise times are important to me. And the other thing is, revisiting a location to find the right light. Because when you go to a location, and it's a fabulous location, you know if you go to that place in noon, and it's high noon, the sun's high up there, everything looks high contrast, and you know highlights will be blown out, and it's very bright, go indoors, have a beer. It's a much better time spent. And then come back when the light is lower, and it's much nicer to photograph out there. Come back and observe the light, because you just never know. When you see the progression of the light throughout the day, you might see certain things in how the light hits the buildings or the people or whatever it is that you might think, okay, that was a better shot. And then during the day in high noon, maybe do portraits, you know, because it's great for pulling people in the shade, having that light bounce off the pavement into some dark area, and it'll make an amazing picture. Trust me on this. I mean, I do most of my indoor work. A lot of my indoor, that indoor I showed you, the home, was shot in high noon because I knew I had nothing else going on and I had to shoot it. So, and then you can use natural light to illuminate the interiors of a place. The other thing, a few other things I do, I organize my images all the time when I'm there. So I use Lightroom, you can use any other software, but at least if you don't, I'm not saying that you have to caption everything, whatever, but at least organize them so they're numbered in one place, you back up, and you keep all the stuff. So that's some, you know, some basic things that you can think about when you're there. All right, so here's the popular slide. What's in the bag? Everybody wants to know. So first, the bag itself, which is not on this list. I love this bag. It's made by a think tank. It's called Airport Antidote 2.0, I think. It's an amazing bag. It'll go on any regional jet. It'll go on any flight, no problems. You know, carry on.
Will it go on Emirates?
Emirates, as well as it'll go on Virgin. It'll go on, like, I flew this tiny jet, and this flight attendant was like, you know, the check-in woman, person was looking at me like strange. I'm like, don't worry, it's gonna go in.
Okay.
And it did. Perfect. It goes in all the time. My favorite thing. Now, as far as, like I said, I'm not a gearhead, but I have certain basic tools that I have to use. So one thing I carry, and may be applicable to some of you, may not be, is always having a backup camera. Because God forbid something happens and you're there, you just don't want to have the situation where your camera stopped working and you're in some place where there's not a B&H close by. So you might need to have another camera. So I use a Mark III and a Mark II. I started off in a Canon. I'm a Canon shooter because I started off shooting Canon. I love Canon cameras. And I have a Mark III and a Mark II, but I was in love with the original 5D. I still am in love with the camera. It's a great camera. Now it looks very archaic and, you know, whatnot, but a lot of those images, you know, came out amazing. The other things I like is, carrying, even though I'm not a big advocate of zoom lenses, even though I have zoom lenses, I always preset the focal length instead of zooming back and forth, because that gives you a sense, that trains your eye and your brain to see things a certain way. Like, you would know right away, even before picking up a camera, how a 50 millimeter lens would look, how a 70 would look, what's a 110, you know, all this kind of stuff. Will only happen if you are disciplined to preset your focal length instead of going back and forth. So I carry zoom lenses only for the ease of not having to carry five lenses. And always fast lenses, because I shoot low light. I'm always, most of the time, shooting ISO 100. Because I like that smoothness, even though modern cameras can go up to ISO 1,000,000, I don't know, whatever it is. But to me, I'm an ISO 100 kind of guy. So I like fast lenses. So I pay for the glass. I know camera bodies will change, but the glass will always be there with you. I love my Zeiss. It's a manual lens, but it creates these beautiful, beautiful images that is a mix of digital and analog. It's like almost playing an old record. It's a 50. It's a 1.4. Yeah, 1.4. 1.4. I can talk to you after that. So, and then aside from that, the next thing, the tripod, is tuition. I call it tuition. You know, anybody knows why? But anyways, in the interest of time, it is because most of the time I probably don't use it. But if I don't carry it, the one time I have to use it, it's not on me. And then I hate myself. So I put tuition all day, carrying it, and then when I have to shoot a long exposure, or if I'm shooting an interior, or if I'm shooting food, for example, sometimes, I put it on a tripod. Trust me. You don't have to put everything on a tripod, but there are certain images where you almost always have to have a tripod. And that's why I call it tuition, because most of the time I'm not using it, but I'm carrying it for the one image. Like the image I showed you, the opener for the Cairo story. And a cable release, always, to avoid camera shake, I use a cable release. It creates conversations, people who don't know what you're doing, they come up and say, hey, what is that thing, you know? I'm like, yeah, it's a cable release, you know, I just have a, you know, again, the best part of being a photographer is to meet people. So any opportunity I can find to talk to people, I would, because I know maybe tomorrow this guy's a great contact to get me the other shot, you know? So just to know people genuinely, have friends, you know, it's an amazing feeling. So I use a cable release as a conversation piece, but more importantly, to control my shutters and to avoid camera shake. And there are other miscellaneous items, but these are the main things. My last portion of this talk is finding outlets. Now, I talked a lot about how these things end up where they are. Now, this is a picture of that exacting proportion series was done as an outdoor installation in Chelsea in a gallery. It was also in a show in Citigroup as prints. So how do I do this? My first thing is, it takes a lot, and I wish I could put double caps on it. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of time not only to develop the body of work, but more importantly, to nurture relationships and to figure out where work will go. A lot of times I have the question asked to me, say, hey, I just want to get my pictures in a show. I want to be famous. Like, good luck. Go get a job, make a lot of money, and maybe. But if you're thinking like that, it's not for you. It has to be done for you, And you really have to love it to the point where you're thinking about it all the time. And I come from a very non-traditional career track as a photographer. And years ago, when someone told me that you really have to love this thing if you want to do this full time, I really didn't understand them until I started and I said, you know what, that's so right. You really have to live it. You really have to think about it all the time. And inspiration will strike, like, you know, I look at billboards, whatever, and I get inspiration. So one of the things I do a lot is portfolio reviews. And that's one time where instead of asking someone or sending that email to a photo editor or a gallerist or a curator, or even worse, walking into a gallery and with your work and saying, hey, I want to show my work and I think I'm great, you should show my work. No, wait for the right moment, have your body of work ready, do your homework, and be presentable in the sense that have your bio ready, have the images in the right order, have something to say, a work statement, whatever it is, because portfolio reviews are one time where curators are thinking about seeing new work and they're actually welcoming. And this applies to not only curators, I do this for my commercial work, my editorial work as well, is when they're actually wanting to see new work, they're open to ideas, open to see new talent, something they haven't seen, and they're not repulsed, they're not busy, they're not catching them in the middle of the day. So take advantage of portfolio reviews, but be careful as to when you look at portfolio reviews, there's a lot of pay-to-play kind of games, which is okay. But make sure that there's at least one or two people in the list of reviewers who you would like to see, not to get the next job, not to get the next show, but just to have a network of people who would appreciate your work, who would give you advice and maybe follow you along. And maybe someday, if the time is right, we'll give you a show, we'll give you an opportunity for publication. Open call for exhibition. There are a lot of them all the time. Call for Entry comes to mind. There's a site called Call for Entry. Galleries in Chelsea do a lot of open calls in the summer. There are artist registries you can upload your work to. I mean, I participated in something called Curate NYC last year. The year before, they do a lot of public installation of works, and it's a bunch of galleries from different parts of the city. They look for emerging talent or work that haven't been, you know, published or shown anywhere. So there's a lot of opportunity. We live in New York, and there's no end to opportunity, but, you know, there are these open calls. Keep an eye out for them. There's also open calls as in, I think that's my next bullet point. Oh, no. Anyways, juried open calls. So sometimes you can have juried calls for shows. But again, when I participate in those, is not because I want to say to my friends, hey, you know, I'm in a show. But more importantly, who is the curator? You know, who is this person that is going to select your work or looking at your work? And you may not be selected, but that person who you respect as an artist or another, you know, individual in the art world will remember you, and maybe you start to build a relationship. You know, send a nice note saying, thank you for reviewing my work. Maybe I didn't get in, but I'd love to keep you posted on my work. Just be genuine, one-to-one, and it goes a long way because it takes a lot of time. Photography art fairs. How many people went to APAD a couple of weeks ago? Yeah, so APAD, it's a show at the Armory in New York. It's once a year. It's all the photography dealers. And a lot of times people say, you know, research your audience, much like I do for my editorial work. Again, since this is also a part of who I am as an artist, I'm also researching galleries and curators who would show work or whose work I admire. And the best place for that to do is an art fair, because you have all the galleries in one place. You can walk around, you know, see what they're showing. Again, it's not like you walk in and say, hey, I'm a photographer, I'm an artist, and I would like you to curate my show. Because they're not there for you. They're there to sell the work. They're looking for collectors. And if you do that right away, I can guarantee you'll never get a show or anything from that curator. So use that as an opportunity for research. Look around, see what's going on in the art world, and chances are your idea has been done before. Steal like an artist, as Warhol would say, right? And you can find that you can bring a different voice to what's been done. Maybe it's your different take on it. Maybe there's something different. Maybe you get inspiration from something you see which is completely unrelated to what you do. Maybe sculpture. You know, the showed you about the icebergs was drawings. You know, and in fact, the original one before that was for these drawings and these napkins. This one art, I forget the name of the artist, used to do while he was commuting on the New York City subways. You know, so it's things like that that brings you, you know, inspiration. Professional organizations. if you know of ASMP, which is American Society of Media Photographers, there's American Photographics Association, I think they're called now, APA. You know, it's a great place to have a community. We are individuals when it comes to being artists, but when you have a community, you can bounce off ideas, you can do photo salons, you can show work, you know, review work. It's a great forum to see how people, you know, respond to your work. And I use that word respond, not positive or negative. Any response is a great response. So photography professional organizations is a great way to also come face-to-face to curators. They have portfolio reviews. So another way to get your work out there or just to build a network. And then, like I said, you know, it all comes down to nurturing relationships. And most of the time that I get to show my work, that I've shown work at the Center for Fine Art Photography or at the gallery in Chelsea or in Citigroup, has come down because they saw my work somewhere and I kept in touch and I said, this is what I'm working on. And there was an opportunity that happened that fit my work. And like even as recent as the Antarctica body of work, I showed it to a gallerist I always want to work with. And I said, this is a work in progress. I want to get your feedback on what you think. This is what I'm trying to do. And they would guide you in certain ways. And it's not like you take every feedback, but it's another data point. So it's a long run, but you're in it for yourself. And it's a fun ride. So that's pretty much what I have for this talk. And I'll open to questions. And please, I'm using social media quite a bit. I use Instagram. I use these three different channels. Just a little one word about social media. I use Twitter as a news feed. I also share important things that I find on Twitter. Instagram, I don't just, you know, take my photo, like my DSLR or my camera, what I've published for work. I don't take those pictures and put them on Instagram. I actually shoot with the iPhone. That's another whole different thing I'm really loving. So I use Instagram quite a bit, and Facebook is a mix of everything. So please keep in touch. That's my handle, no matter which platform you find me. But I'd love to hear from you, and if you have any questions, let's open it up.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.